Welcome to the Lord's house for worship on this beautiful, slightly cool, but beautiful fall morning. It's good to have everyone in person. It's also good to see those through the web stream, and we ask God's blessings to be upon you all as well. Just a few things quickly by way of announcement. Please remember today is the deadline for your poinsettia orders for the Advent season. Advent begins 2 weeks from today. So if you would please get those in today. Tomorrow technically is the deadline, the 15th. That way Sally can get that order finalized and get that in this coming week so we can have those in place for the first Sunday in Advent on the 28th. This coming week, if you're a part of the Senior Adventures Group, please remember your trip this Thursday. You will be leaving from the church at 10:30. You will enjoy lunch at Golden Corral at 11, and then you will head on to the Rudy Theater for their Christmas show at 12:45. Again, that is this coming Thursday. 1 week from yesterday, it is the Trinity Circle Shopping Spree. That will be taking place in the CEC from 9 a.m. until 3 p.m. A number of great vendors to help you out with your Christmas shopping this year. There is a $1 admission fee. And then we have our blood drive, which I believe Chris is going to say a little bit more about the blood drive. Anything you want to add to that on behalf of Alice?
Just if possible, to register all
the
app.
Okay. Okay. Sounds good. I'll relay a little bit of that over. Basically, if you have the opportunity to pre-register for the blood drive, if you have access to the American Red Cross app on your phone, you can go ahead and knock that out really quickly. You can also take care of your rapid pass, which is the questionnaire they always ask prior to your donations. One thing that's a little bit special about this particular blood drive, we're really wanting to reach out to those in the community who may be able to help out with sickle cell patients. That is a major issue. That is a big blood shortage right now for the Red Cross. So if you know individuals who might be able to give to help out with sickle cell patients, please encourage them to come as well. Marcy, anything?
Don't forget that we have the Trinity Shopping Spree this Saturday, 9 to 3. So come out and shop. We have many different vendors who will be coming and selling different types of things, crafts, homemade things, all kinds of baked goods. We still have room for vendors? Yes, we still have room for vendors. So if you would like to be a vendor, let Pam or Jeanette know as soon as possible. I still have not made the reservations to Bethlehem, so if you would like to go with us on the journey to Bethlehem, that is at Stony Creek. That is the Saturday, December 4th, and we need to be there at 6:30. Please let me know today so that I can make those reservations. We are still working on Jingle at the Park. I have not finalized those plans with the town yet, so more information about that will be coming soon. Also, more information will be coming soon about the angel tree. We will still be doing that this year. We have about 21 kids who we will be helping. These kids have all attended, or a sibling of the family has attended our programs sometime throughout this year. And they are in need of help for Christmas. So the level of their need differs sometimes from family to family. We will be taking monetary donations as well as donations of toys. But more information about that will be shared later. But we'll go ahead and take monetary donations if you're ready to do so. And at this time, let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Jesus, would I know more of his grace to
Please stand and join us in our responsive call to worship. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the holy ones in the land, they are noble, in whom is all my delight. Those who choose another god multiply their sorrows. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names upon my lips. The Lord is chosen proportion in my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. Brother Richie Balance, will you lead us in our invocation?
Good morning.
Good morning.
You can smile, and if we do bad, you can laugh. It won't hurt our feelings.
Feed me till I want no more.
Our gospel lesson today comes from Mark 13, 1 through 8. Mark 13, 1 through 8. As he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be, and what will the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God.
As we go to our Heavenly Father in prayer this morning, I call your attention to the back portion of the bulletin. You'll see many names reflected there within our church family and extended community. Today we also include the name of Pam White upon our prayer list. Are there other names you would have us to mention?
Also, my other sister, Jennifer Kearns, is in the hospital.
Okay. So your sister Jenny, in addition to your sister Pam. All right. Joyce.
My cousin Chris Moore.
Cousin Chris Moore.
And her husband Curtis.
And cousin.
He's having surgery this week. He's recovering from
COVID. All right. We'll remember the two of them. Anyone else?
Kelly, remember Betsy as well.
Remember Betsy. Okay. The Robert Hooks family.
Dennis Harrell.
Dennis Harrell. Perhaps through uplifted hands. God sees each and every heart, and God understands the depths of our needs. Would you bow with me for a moment of prayer? Lord, we all long to be filled. We wish to be satisfied, whether it's sharing a meal, as we'll do momentarily during lunch, or whether it's when we think about our circle of family and friends who help us fill the empty spaces in life, or maybe even beyond that, the spiritual longing of our hearts. Lord, so often we're satisfied with what we have. But Lord, we often know that there's so much more that we could have of you if we would yield our lives to your lordship, if we would allow you to fill all of our being. Lord, that's not with tangible things, wealth, and possessions, but it's through an abiding relationship with your Son, Jesus, through the presence of your Holy Spirit. Lord, fill us to the point of overflowing so that we may be the vessels that you've called us to be, sharing your good news everywhere that we go in the days to come. Lord, we know we live in a time that's troubling, as Marcy has read from Mark chapter 13. But we know that you continue to be God. You continue to make your presence and power known in the world through the presence of the church. Enable us, Lord, to be the shining light that we should be in these times. Even as we get down and discouraged, may we be instruments of hope, peace, joy, and love to the world around us so that others may know the difference that you can still make in a world of brokenness. Lord, today we thank you for so many blessings that you have supplied us with, and for the wonderful assurance that we can bring any and everything into your presence through prayer, and know that you will feel us, that you will hear us, that you will understand everything that we're wrestling with at this moment. Lord, we think of so many families who've been touched by sickness and death in recent days and weeks. There are those who are dealing with hospitalizations and periods of recovery. You are our great physician. And even though we may not understand the how and the why of various circumstances, we know that you are still present, seeing us through these moments. Lord, hear us as we pray, as we agree together in a spirit of unity as sisters and brothers in the faith, shouldering these burdens together and placing them before your throne of grace. Now, Lord, continue to be with us in this season of worship, and even more that we may go out from this place and this time together back to the mission field, where we can be the hands and feet that you have called and created us to be in the days to come. This prayer, Father, we lift up in your Son's most precious and holy name, Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Oh.
If you'll stand and join me in the affirmation of faith, which is the priesthood of Jesus Christ. Let us begin. Just as we are flesh and blood, Jesus, the Son of God, took on human form so that through his death he might destroy the one who has the power of death and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. Therefore, he had to become like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might be merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the people. We affirm that it is fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, blameless, undefiled, and exalted above the heavens. Unlike other high priests, he has no need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for those of the people. This he did once for all when he offered himself. Thanks be unto God. Amen. At this time, you may be seated and the children may come with me to Junior Church.
Our sermon text for today is taken from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 11 through 14 and 19 through 25. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 11 through 14 and 19 through 25. May we give ear to the reading of God's word. And every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. And since then, he has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter into the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a pure heart or a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Brothers and sisters, may God add a blessing to this, the reading, hearing, understanding, and living of these words for our days. Thanks be to God. Amen. One and done. It's a phrase that's been common throughout the realm of sports, particularly college basketball, for several years now. Speaking of those athletes who go to college and after their freshman year, they decide to move on to the NBA draft. You don't hear it as much in other sports, but especially in college basketball, it may be that an athlete helps lead a team on to victory in a national championship. It may be that it's more than one athlete. I think a few years ago it was Kentucky, who there toward the end of the season had a number of players start to declare their eligibility for the NBA draft. The idea is that they would go and play, but realizing their potential, knowing that they are top athletes, they don't want to do anything that could jeopardize their future in professional sports, so they decide to move on from those other 3 years of college. I know we all have thoughts and feelings and convictions when it comes to college athletes, but it's what it's become known as, a one-and-done kind of scenario. But it's not really limited just to the realm of college sports. I think, for example, in the world of motorsports, if a team is given 2 laps of qualification, many times they will stand on their first lap knowing that the second lap has a good possibility of being slower than the first. It's a one and done. I think about a commercial some years ago that came out that posed a question: what if everything was as simple as one? One push-up, one little morsel of food, one whatever, a pill, you name it, that could simplify life, that could make our health better, our exercise easier, you fill in the blank. But is it really all that simple? Think about the many things that need repeating. I know many of you have taken a flu shot for this year. You probably did so last year, the year before, and will have to do so again next year. Probably my least favorite would be in the realm of pressure washing. I would love to think that you could pressure wash a building and it's good to go for its lifetime, but guess what? It's not. That north side is still going to need that pressure washing next year and the year after and the year after that. I was reminded of that just a couple of weeks ago as they were pressure washing this side of the church buildings, the steeple, and I thought, man, I'm glad I'm not the guy up in the bucket doing the steeple today. It's something that has to reoccur. A car oil change. Our consumption of food. We need meals to have energy to get through our days. We can't eat just one meal and be good to go for life. It's the story of life where there's going to be all types of reoccurrences. Rarely, if ever, can you say that something in life is a one and done kind of scenario. That is until we think about God's grace. That is when we come to the words of the author known as the letter of Hebrews, this many times debated anonymous work is perhaps the most Jewish of anything that we have in the New Testament. Maybe we consider Matthew's gospel, which is the most Jewish of the four gospels. But other than that gospel, Hebrews weighs heavily upon the Old Testament. And having an idea of the Hebrew covenants and being able to understand the law, the sacrificial system, and all of the things that went along with purification for God's people prior to the time of Christ. For several weeks now, the Sunday school lessons had been coming from the book of Hebrews. Now they've transitioned over to some different stories from the Old Testament. But in those lessons, if you'll recall from Hebrews, there was quite a bit of overlap. It spoke initially that God has spoken throughout history in many different ways. He sent messengers, prophets, angels, but now at just the right time in history, He has spoken through the giving of His Son, the Word made flesh. But that Word didn't simply come to live a nice, virtuous life. It did not come to live so that other people would have their needs taken care of. Ultimately, the Word was made flesh to give that life on behalf of our sinfulness. We know the story. We know it inside and out. We dwell upon it during the Easter season and Lent leading up to Easter. But my, how often we take it for granted. Once again, in his writing, the author of Hebrews draws his reader's attention back to what Christ has done. Nothing that needs repeating, but something that Christ has done once and for all. Something that is completed, it is signed, sealed, delivered. No need to do it again ever. A sacrifice for the sins of humanity, for all of time. The sacrificial system of the Old Testament was very detailed, very tedious as far as what was prescribed, what was recommended for the people to do. And they had certain rites and rituals that they had to go through on a regular basis. And the sacrifices needed to be a certain type of animal at a certain quality. They needed to be performed for different reasons in different scenarios, but they had to go on and on and on and on and on. I would love to know throughout the history of Judaism, at least prior to the year 70 when Jerusalem was destroyed, the temple was broken down, and the sacrificial system officially ended. In that span of history, how many sacrifices were actually made to God? How many lambs, how many rams, how many oxen? All to try to gain merit with God. All to bring healing and restoration because sin had broken fellowship with God's people. But now that Christ has come into the world, there goes the sacrificial system. There goes our need to come to this place of worship week after week, if not day after day, with a piece of livestock to be slaughtered, its blood spilled, its meat placed upon the altar and set afire in order that that aroma might come into the presence of God and that God might see our act of forgiveness, our need for repentance, our act that we're trying to get things turned around for the better in our lives. Can you imagine what it would be like as church if we did that every single day? If I had to stand at this altar and wait for you to bring in that animal, can you imagine the time? Can you imagine how inconvenient it would be to stop whatever it was that you were doing that was pretty important for you and your family? Oh, it's time for sacrifice. Or I have this sin in my life that needs to be dealt with, so I've got to go down to the church and render my sacrifice before God. My, how things have changed. My, how different the world is because of what Christ has done once and for all. Why is this so important? Perhaps you're already thinking, well, preacher, we know this story. We hear it over and over. We have it. We've committed it to memory. Why is this significant? And why today, especially as we're winding down the church year? Next Sunday is known as Christ the King Sunday. It concludes the Christian year, and we begin Advent, as I said earlier, in 2 weeks, which is the beginning, the inauguration of the Christian year. I share this because so often we forget the nature of the gift that we have through what Jesus has done. We remember the story maybe from a sentimental vantage point that God so loved the world that Jesus died on the cross, that he was raised again on the third day. But many times we do not consider what this gift is doing and has already done in our lives. One of the first things that we can find through this scripture today is the guarantee that God's forgiveness is a guarantee. There are so many things in life that are not guarantees. You can watch a TV commercial for a car company, a construction company, some kind of service. We guarantee that you will be satisfied. We guarantee. We stand behind this. We'll do whatever it takes. But let's be honest, how many guarantees really stand the test of time over the years? Very few things. They're few and far between in our world. But when we think about what the author of Hebrews has said and how these words continue to speak to us today, we have that guarantee that God has forgiven us, that God will forgive us, that God is forgiving us. And that seems so simple, but often it's so neglected within the community of faith. Because we live in a world where it's easy to hold things against other people. It's easy to drum up someone's past. It's easy to talk about who they were prior to Christ. It's easy to talk about all of their faults and their failures in life. But how many of us are really quick to focus on who a person is, maybe once they've tried to put the past behind them? Let's be honest, it's easier, it's a little more fun, it's more popular in our society to focus on what was rather than what is and what is becoming through a person's new life in Christ. How many of us are in need of those words that you were forgiven? I think about author Tom Long in his commentary on the book of Hebrews. He says that this text, really the whole book of Hebrews, but especially this passage, when you have read over and over and over again that Christ died as the full and final sacrifice for humanity, this is the ultimate assurance of pardon. Many times when we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we'll have an affirmation of faith. But we'll also have a call of confession, a prayer where we repent of our sins, and then usually Marcy or I will offer words of assurance. Because God has done this through Jesus, you are forgiven. I had a professor long ago that taught me some very important words. I thought that in our culture, I love you is the most important phrase that can be said. That's powerful. It's essential to our relationships to other people, our spouses, our family, our friends. But this professor said, equally as important, if not of even greater value, are these other three words: you are forgiven. How many of us have lived life burdened by our past? How many of us have lived with hard feelings, frustration, animosity because a relationship didn't turn out so well? Or maybe we've been trying to make amends in that situation, but to no avail. And then finally something happens, a moment out of the blue. That person comes to us and says, Kelly, I want to let you know I forgive you. How freeing those words are. What a burden is lifted from our lives when someone tells us that we are forgiven. Not just the, oh, I'm sorry, okay, I forgive you. Go out and do the same thing again and again and again, a lot like a child to a parent. But I mean true forgiveness. How powerful that is in our human relationships. How much more so in our relationship with the Creator of the universe, the Lord of all things, the Savior of the world, hearing words that because of what I've done through the giving of my Son, I've taken the initiative to fix your problem. And because of that, you are forgiven. Whether we have those casual missteps in our lives, whether we've had an affair, whether we've had negative feelings toward other people, regardless of what that sin looks like for each of us individually, those are some of the most powerful words. And when God says, you are forgiven, you are forgiven, you are forgiven, I am forgiven, God truly means it, not to bring it up again, not to throw our past into our faces, but to truly give us a fresh start. It is a one and done situation. Now, certainly we still stumble. We still have need for confession in our lives consistently, but know without a shadow of doubt, when you ask God for forgiveness because of Jesus, you are forgiven. No questions asked. A second point that we find in the text is the fact that what God has done, this grace that he has given, is no superficial kind of fix. When God brings forgiveness into our lives, it's not simply to dust some things off at a surface level. God does this to get inside and work deep down within. People familiar with automotive terms would say that this is a full overhaul. Just like an engine that needs to be rebuilt or a car that needs a total restoration. There's not a lot to work with, so it needs everything. That's what God's forgiveness does in us, is the deep kind of clean, the deep kind of fix that we all have need of. In the verses in between what I read initially and closed with, there's some wording that's quoted from the prophet Jeremiah, specifically Jeremiah chapter 31. You find that in verses 15 through 18. And these words are not necessarily unique to Jeremiah, for they speak a lot about the mentality of the prophets of that day and time in the Old Testament and how they understood what God was trying to do on behalf of God's people. Time and again in the Old Testament amongst the prophets, we hear words saying that I want to create a new covenant within you, but it's not going to be one that's just on the surface. It's not going to be simply rules and regulations that you say, sounds good, God, we're going to follow those things. But the prophets say that the changes that God longs to deal with are going to be in the heart. How many times do we read in Scripture, I'm going to turn that heart of stone into a heart of flesh. I'm going to soften up all of that sin, all of that hatred, all of that stuff in your life that's hindering you from being who I want you to be as my people. The circumcision that I long for is not a circumcision of the flesh, as the Jews really held up as being important to their covenant. It says the circumcision I want is a circumcision of the heart. I want to get into your heart and fix what's really messing things up in your life. I don't want to give you a temporary fix. I don't want to just fix what other people see on the surface when you encounter people daily. I want to fix the brokenness. I want to take away that anger. I want to get in there and soften that heart so that you can be filled with my Spirit so that then you can live as my people should live. A deep clean. An internal fix. That's hard work. In fact, let's be honest, it's downright uncomfortable when we let God have the deepest, darkest recesses of our lives and we allow God to fix that stuff in our lives that we've held on to for so very long. We get comfortable with our sin. It becomes a natural part of who we are and how we function. We can't imagine our lives without it, so we try to hold it back from God. But God wants to get in there and give us each a new heart, because until the heart is dealt with, nothing is going to change. Nothing is going to change in my life or your life. Nothing is going to change within our society. Nothing in this whole wide world or even universe is going to change until we let God deal with our hearts. It's not a superficial fix. A third and final thing that I would say that God has accomplished through the giving of His Son and through His Son being that sacrifice, not just offering the sacrifice like any other priest, but being the sacrifice Himself, is this: we can approach God with confidence. We can approach God with confidence. We don't have to approach God with fear. At the same time, we don't approach God with arrogance and pride, as if God owes us something, as if we're entitled to something in life. No, we can face God with confidence. And what does the author mean by that? What is bound up in that word confidence? It's the idea of integrity. I can go into the presence of God with a clear and open conscience. I can express myself to God in full integrity because of what God has done for me. God has wiped the slate clean. God has taken the sin out of my life. Now there's no longer the dividing wall. The author speaks of those very words when he talks about we now have access to God through the curtain. Here in Hebrews, it speaks of the curtain being the body of Christ. But when we think about the temple and its construction, there was a veil that went between the holy place and the holy of holies, and only certain people under certain conditions could go into the holy of holies on the day of atonement to offer a sacrifice before the mercy seat of God. Nobody else went through the veil. But when we read the story of Jesus' passion, His death, it tells us when He gave up the ghost that the temple veil was torn in two. That which truly separated us from God was pulled back, we might say, giving us access to God that was exclusive just to the priests of that day and time. Today, you and I have access to God. The question is, what do we do with that access to God? How do we approach God daily? And by that, I don't simply mean telling God what we want or what we need, where it hurts, but coming before God as the Creator, the Lord, the Sustainer of this universe, and saying, God, here I am. I come just as I am, and I come because of Your forgiveness. I come because I have received what You have given to me and all of humanity through the giving of Your Son, Jesus. I receive that into my life. Now here is my life. Take it and let it be used for You. Today, I wonder, how do we treat this grace of God? If we're honest, we probably take it for granted. Maybe we've been saved, been a member of the church for a really long time, and so it just seems like it's a part of our lives. We speak the church language. We know what it means to get saved, but I mean, today, when we let God really get in there and do life, specifically heart-transforming work, how could our lives change? How could our world change? How could our church change? How could this community change? If we took Christ's sacrifice serious and allowed him to heal us, to cleanse us, to forgive us, to make us new through and through. It's not because of anything that you and I do. It's because of what God has done. And sisters and brothers, that was a one and done. Thanks be unto God. Amen and amen. Today, our hymn of commitment video, a song that has been very meaningful in my faith walk. Many of you may be familiar with it. It's by Chris Tomlin. It's entitled At the Cross, and the subtitle of it is Love Ran Red. That's what happened at the cross. God's love was poured out for all of humanity, all of us, no matter how mixed up and messed up our lives are, that sacrifice was for all of us. Love wasn't simply handing us a present like we'll exchange in a few weeks at Christmas. Love was a life that was given, a life that became a sacrifice. Blood was spilt once and for all for us to be forgiven. If you've never accepted Christ and invited him in to be your Lord and Savior, will you come? This altar is open. Today, this moment can be your time of salvation. Maybe you would like to unite with the Little Rock family and be a more complete part of God's working in and through our community of faith. Perhaps there are burdens that are weighing heavy upon your hearts, or even praise items you would like to come and give thanks for before God's throne of grace. No matter the need, no matter the condition of your heart, this altar is open. Will we respond as God's Spirit is leading?
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, where all the love I've ever found
God's love ran red once and for all. And that's the gift that God has for each and every one of us. And that's the gift that God has called us each to go forth and to live out and to share everywhere that we go in the days to come. Would you stand for our benediction as we close this time of worship, as we prepare to go forth and serve, and also for the blessing of this week's offering? Would you bow with me? Heavenly Father, what an awesome gift. The full and final sacrifice of your Son Jesus for the sins of humanity. Even in the midst of our broken state, you loved us enough to send Jesus into the world to die and to be raised again on that third day so that we might have life and life abundantly. Lord, may we embrace this grace every moment of every day. May it transform how we live, how we do things, our motivation, the way we speak. May this grace be our story. And Lord, may we live in such a way that others know the power of your salvation as well. Father, we ask that you would bless also these tithes and offerings we're about to receive. Multiply them and use them for the ongoing work of your kingdom here upon earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ.